Lord, thank you so much again, Lord, for your goodness and just singing about, Lord, how amazing you are. And truly, Lord, your word is able to guide us and direct us and lead us, Lord, into everlasting, Lord, to your heart. That's where we want to be, Lord. We want to be close to you, not caught up in the place, but the person and who you are. And so we thank you not only for who you are, but also for what you did on the cross for us and rising again, Lord, in power and just understanding positionally, Lord, that we are your children and we're able to access the throne room of grace. And what a blessing that is. I pray, Lord, that you would have grace on us tonight, that you would pour out your spirit upon our hearts. Lord, that you would teach us, that you would continue to mature us as we seek your word, as we continue to draw near to you. Give us this day our daily bread, Lord. That's what we desire to hear from you, and your word is that bread, Lord, that we live off of, Lord. So we love you, we thank you, and we pray you bless this time in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, so we're in Exodus. I titled it A Change of Time. So everyone agrees that Moses wrote the book of Exodus, and it was written basically after the wilderness wanderings, coming out of Egypt, 1445 BC, and so maybe written about 1405 or so. And most people believe that Moses wrote Exodus, and it was mainly for the 12 tribes of Israel, so that they would not forget the goodness of the Lord and how God led them out of, you know, the Exodus, right? Led them out of Egypt, and as well as the, you know, giving the law, the tabernacle, the furnishings, and but just to see the hand of the Lord was mighty in those days, and not to neglect, not to forget. They weren't led out of Egypt by the hand of man, but it was by the power of God, right? And so Exodus is going to be so powerful as we go through it. It's going to be a blessing. And if you're a note taker, Exodus can be broken up really in three sections. I put it on the screen for you for all of our understanding. And all of them deal with the children of Israel. And Israel is in Egypt in chapters 1 through 12. And we're going to see Israel in the wilderness in chapter 13 all the way to verse 8, or chapter 18. And Israel's at Sinai in chapters 19 all the way to the end at chapter 40. So that's kind of how we're going to break down our studies in the book of Exodus. And if you're taking notes today, we're going to look at three main, really simple things today in this chapter. The first is the fulfillment of this prophecy, the fulfillment of prophecy in verses 1 through 7. Let's go ahead and start at verse 1. It says, "Now these are the names of the children of Israel who came to Egypt. Each man and his household came with Jacob," or Israel, "Reuben, Simeon, Levi, and Judah, Issachar, Zebulun, and Benjamin, Dan, Naphtali, Gad, and Asher. All those who were descendants of Jacob were 70 persons." So you guys remember Joseph was in Egypt already. "And Joseph died, all his brothers and all that generation." You guys remember we talked about this in our studies in Genesis, about the 70 already in Egypt. So Genesis 46, we talked about Acts chapter 7, when Stephen was recounting some of it, and 1 Chronicles chapter 7 as well. But I said this section is dealing with the fulfillment of prophecy. And since Jacob and all that generation had all passed away, in fact, in Genesis chapter 50, verse 26, it says, "So Joseph died, being 110 years old, and they embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt." So he was 110 years old when he died. And I think this relates to prophecy, since from the death of Joseph until the time of Exodus, so about 1445 BC, there is a 400-year gap time. And so That is a direct fulfillment, by the way, of Genesis chapter 15, verse 13. If you guys remember, when God was talking to Abraham, God told Abraham, he said, "Know certainly that your descendants will be strangers in a land that is not theirs, and will serve them, and they will afflict them 400 years." Interesting. So in verses 1 through 6, this is the fulfillment of prophecy already. So when you're reading the first verses, you got to slow down and recognize every verse was put there for a specific reason. God is saying, hey, I am faithful. What I said came to pass. And that's just it. It's interesting. Everything that God prophesied came true. 400 years they're going to be afflicted. 400 years, isn't that crazy? We think about our trials and our tribulations that we go through. They were afflicted for 400 years. It was not easy. And so it always seems like, you know, when we're going through an affliction in our life, it's almost like God wants to stretch that out, right? It's like, can I just go through it for like one day or 2 days? But he's like, how about a year or 5 or 20 or 40, right? And it's like, oh. But he doesn't allow us to go through affliction to bum us out. He allows us to go through affliction to bless us, to build us up, to bring us into maturity as his children. And it may seem, you know, that the Lord is taking his time sometimes, or maybe he's not listening, but he is. That's when you guys are at school, right? That when is the teacher the quietest? It's during a test, right? And the Lord brings us through tests. And sometimes, you know, just because you're not hearing from him doesn't mean that he's not there. He's definitely there, right? He'll never leave you nor forsake you as his church. So we see one prophecy being fulfilled here in verses 1 through 6. But there's another one being fulfilled in verse 7. It says in verse 7, "But the children of Israel were fruitful and increased abundantly, multiplied and grew exceedingly mighty, and the land was filled with them." So this is exactly what God had promised them. Back in Genesis chapter 46, verse 3, he says, "So he said, I am God, the God of your father. Do not fear to go down to Egypt, for I will make of you a great nation there." God promised and fulfilled his promise by using affliction. God, I think it's interesting. He said it, and he made good on his promises. Isn't that wonderful? If God said it, we can count on it. I think it's interesting in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. This should bless all of us. It says, "By which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust." Now here's the problem. We think it's on our timing, but the fact is it's on God's timing. When God wants to bring you through something, he wants to bring you out of something. It's not based on our understanding of when God should do something. His ways are far greater than our ways, right? And his ways are always best. So it's just interesting. We always think our ways are, you know, it's like, Lord, can you do this? Can you do that for me? I mean, sometimes we ask and not know what we're really asking for. And it's good to just, that's why it's good to just recognize that God's in heaven. Let your words be few. And just wait on the Lord. There's wisdom in that, because then your words are spoken out of wisdom and not blurting out so quick without knowledge, right? And we got to be cautious. So let's go on to the second thing here, Pharaoh's affliction. We're going to look at Pharaoh's affliction in verses 8 through 14. Verse 8 says, "Now there arose a new king over Egypt who did not know Joseph." Now, this is a new king. You guys remember, 400 years has already passed. Oh, wake up! 4 years has already passed at this moment. It's interesting, if you guys recall Stephen, the first martyr, there in Acts chapter 7, when he was recounting about Moses, about this time, in Acts chapter 7, verse 18, he says, "Till another king arose who did not know Joseph, And I looked up this word another in Acts chapter 7 that Stephen used. And this word another is in Greek, it's heteros, which really speaks of another of a different kind, which I thought was interesting because another word for another is allos, which means another of the same kind. So this king, this pharaoh, is another of a different kind. So this is an entirely different kind of king that really just came onto the scene, and he definitely does not know or heard of Joseph. So in fact, Isaiah 52, verse 4, it says, "My people went down at first into Egypt to dwell there. Then the Assyrian oppressed them without cause." So this king would actually be an Assyrian king. And so he's not about the Egyptian dynasty. He's not about the Egyptian traditions and the Egyptian methods and all of that stuff. Look at verse 9. It says, "And he said to his people, 'Look, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we.'" That must have been a humbling thing to say for a king. "Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, lest they multiply and it happen in the event of war, that they also join our enemies and fight against us, and so go up out of the land. Therefore they set taskmasters over them to afflict them with their burdens. And they built for Pharaoh supply cities, Pithom and Ramses. But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew. And they were in dread of the children of Israel. So the Egyptians made the children of Israel serve with rigor. And they made their lives bitter with hard bondage in mortar and brick and in all manner of service in the field. All their service in which they made them serve was with rigor." So Pharaoh sees that these Hebrews are multiplying. And the more I afflict them, they're multiplying. That's the same principle. If you guys remember, we've been going through the book of Acts on Sunday. That's the same thing that we've been seeing with the early church, right? The more the enemy wanted to persecute the early church, what happened? They continued to multiply under persecution. Without persecution, everything was barely almost like the American, you know, relaxed, comfortable Christian, right? Where it's like, why grow? There's nothing to stress me out right now. Why should I seek the Lord? I got a call from somebody today that saw something in their house, and it just reminded me. Immediately they ran to the Lord, but I asked them, I was like, you know, did you have plans to be praying tonight? Did you have plans to be reading God's word and seeking Him? And she's like, no. I was like, and I wonder why God allows us to see certain things, you know, and experience things. And I think the Lord is just wanting to draw us near. And He uses persecution as well in the church so that we come to Him with full abandonment, right? Like, Lord, I'm all in. That's what He always wants us to be, surrendered in our hearts to Him all the time. That's what it means. Pick up your cross and follow Him. It's not following yourself. It's not after your own reputation, or all of that is gone. You're looking forward and you're pressing into Jesus in all things, which I love, which is interesting. So this is why reading your Bible, you come to understand that affliction is actually a good thing. David understood this in Psalm 119, verse 67. He says, "Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word." It's interesting how God uses affliction to grow us. And God used Egypt as a type of, you know, the world to afflict His people. And the world still does, they do that to us today. What they think is evil, we know, you know, God will use it for good, you know, in the end, which is interesting. But it's interesting because God wants to shape us and mold us, but his tool that He picks up usually to form us and transform us is affliction, but because of that we gain endurance, right? We gain patience, like James talks about. We gain a lot of stuff going through those times of affliction. So it's interesting because reading about the children of Israel, you know, this whole time in Genesis and Exodus, it may seem sad, but in the end, we know the end results, right? And in the end of our lives today, we know the end results as well. So these afflictions that we go through, they're not going to last for eternity. They're here for a time. And we got to rejoice that the Lord knows what he's doing in our hearts. He brings us through these things because he wants you to bless him. He wants to bless you with those afflictions. But at the time, we just don't see it. But let's come to the third thing here, is the fear of God. The fear of God. In verses 15 to 22, this is dealing with the midwives and killing the Hebrew babies. Look at verse 15. It says, "Then the king of Egypt spoke to the Hebrew midwives, of whom the name of one was Shiphrah, and the name of the other Puah. And he said, when you do the duties of a midwife for the Hebrew women, you see them on the birth stools. If it is a son, then you shall kill him. But if it is a daughter, then she shall live." Now Pharaoh understood that afflicting the people only magnified the problem. And so he tried to set up his own game basically here, right? When the Hebrew women were having children, they were having children, you know, super fast. They were just multiplying like crazy. So, but he got this plan to get the midwives, right, to kill every male that they see. And it would seem like these two midwives, you know, just by reading it, it seems like these two were in charge of all of the midwives. And so whatever their word was, all the rest of the midwives were to listen to, in a sense. But look at verse 17. It says, "But the midwives feared God." Don't miss that. The midwives feared God and did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but saved the male children alive. And so the king of Egypt called for the midwives and said to them, "Why have you done this thing and saved the male children alive?" And the midwife said to Pharaoh, "Because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women, for they are lively and give birth before the midwives come to them. Therefore God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and grew very mighty. And so it was, because the midwives feared God, that he provided households for them." So Pharaoh commanded all of his people, saying, "Every son who is born you shall cast into the river, and every daughter you shall save alive." This is really a familiar passage in scripture that a lot of us already know. And I noticed a few things, though, about the midwives. Notice the action of the midwives here. They didn't kill the male babies. And when they were questioned about it, they said it was too late, right? They're giving birth too quick. The moment we get to their house, I mean, bloop, there goes the baby already. it's too fast. It's interesting. I love midwives, by the way. I got three kids, right? And Amariah was about, 15 hours, and my wife was in labor, and Amariah was born. Malachi was a lot quicker, about 9, and then Ezra was probably, 5 or 6 hours. But the midwives are amazing. I'm here cheering my wife on, and like, I could just breathe like this. What do you need? I'm trying to massage her, or, you know, get it. But I take a glance over, and if they're not over helping her, they're out like cleaning our house. It's like, what are you doing? Get over here. But it's a blessing. If you guys know midwives, to me, they're like superheroes. So when I read these midwives here, it's pretty neat to see. You know, that they feared the Lord. And that some people read this and they say, you know, the midwives, they feared the Lord, and that's why they didn't do it. Others say they didn't do it, but they lied to Pharaoh. And lying to Pharaoh, right? Kind of, and they associate it with Rahab, if you guys remember in Joshua. You guys remember they're in Jericho, and Rahab saves the two spies. They come in, and then the king asks, you know, where are they at? And there she's like, oh, they're not on my roof, right? They're not here. I don't know. But anyways, she's actually in the Hall of Faith. Did you guys know that in Hebrews chapter 11? She is a harlot, a liar, if you will, because of that, right? But she's a Gentile, but she's in the hall of faith. And I think that's interesting, not because she lied, but because she had faith in the Lord. She had faith in the Lord. And the same thing here. These midwives had faith in the Lord. They trusted in the Lord. They feared the Lord. They weren't about to, step in and obey whatever the king said. They knew morally, before the Lord, spiritually, if you will, that it was wrong. And today is interesting. There's a lot of people that do the exact same thing. Maybe they're in the healthcare industry, and they're saying, "Hey, give this to this type of people, and make sure they take it, knowingly that they might die from it." And nurses and other people, they don't give them those things. There's like superheroes that are not in capes these days, right? And they're like the ninjas that they go to work every day and they're saving lives. And nobody knows about it. Why? Because they fear the Lord. They want to honor God, and they know they don't care about it. What's a job, right? If your boss says, "You do this, you're going to lose a job," when it becomes immoral, right, unbiblical, you have all the right to say, "No, I'm not going to do it at all." So anyways, just a few of my thoughts on that. But notice the midwives, by the way, it mentioned it twice, that they feared the Lord. And so that's where I'm kind of leaning more so towards, is that that's the reason why they feared the Lord. So look at chapter 2. Moses comes on the scene here in chapter 2. And Moses is in there in Egypt for 40 years. And then he's going to be in the Midian desert for another 40 years. And then he's going to be in the Sinai wilderness for another 40 years. I like how the Lord gave us, made it very easy for us in the future. But I noticed four things about Moses in this chapter. The first thing is, let's look at the birth of Moses. In verses 1 through 4, the birth of Moses. It says, "And a man of the house of Levi went and took as wife a daughter of Levi." Now this man is Amram in Exodus chapter 6, verse 20. The daughter's name is Jochebed. And so in verse 2, it says, "So the woman conceived and bore a son. And when she saw that he was a beautiful child, she hid him 3 months." So one of the first things that we learn about Moses is he was a beautiful child. Isn't that cool? Most mothers say that their child is very beautiful, right? But we know the truth about some babies, right? You have a baby, for sure. Look at that baby. That for some reason, they're like, "Oh, what if he wasn't a beautiful..." Did you guys think about this? I think about this stuff. What if he was... "Oh, yeah, just take him." You know, what is that? Why would they even say that he was a beautiful child? I don't know. That's interesting. But let's keep going. It says in verse 3, "But when she could no longer hide him, she took an ark of bulrushes for him, daubed it with asphalt and pitch, and put the child in it and laid it in the reeds by the river's bank." Now, here she made an ark. Question for you guys, by the way. How many arks are mentioned in the Bible? Three? Oh, you guys are good. The answer is 3. Good job. Moses' ark, right, that his mom made. We got Noah's ark, and then we got God's ark, if you will, the ark of the covenant, the mercy seat is, right? Interesting. That's a cool. Good job, guys. Look at verse 4. It says, "And his sister stood afar off to know what would be done to him." So Moses' sister, we know, is Miriam. Here Moses is, he's three-month-old baby. He's put into this ark, this little boat-looking thing. And then he's put into the Nile River. By the way, it's interesting because the Nile River, that's where they're throwing all the other babies. You see all the Egyptians on the sides, they're throwing other babies. There's probably crocodiles or, you know, things in the water that are, it's bad. And in the same water, here's Moses protected in the midst of all the wrath all around him, if you will. But it's by faith that he was able to go through in this basket, basically. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 23, it says, "By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden 3 months by his parents because they saw he was a beautiful child, and they were not afraid of the king's command." And so it was by faith, and pretty sure that's what my mom said when I was born too, right? It's like, "Oh, look, a beautiful child." Just joking. Too quiet here, guys. Just trying to lighten it up. But notice her faith was manifested in 2 days. It was by her actions. That's true faith right here. And James chapter 2 talks about, you know, your faith in action. But let's look at the nursing of Moses. In verses 5 through 10, the nursing of Moses, it says in verse 5, "Then the daughters of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river, and her maidens walked along the riverside. And when she saw the ark among the reeds, she sent her maid to get it. And when she opened it, she saw the child, and behold, the baby wept. And so she had compassion on him and said, 'This is one of the Hebrews' children.'" So we're told that he's a beautiful child, and now we're told that he's a crybaby, right? Which is interesting. But again, we talked about last week about in Genesis about providence. Isn't it interesting that of all the people that saw Moses first, it happened to be Pharaoh's daughter? Everything is happening here. The stage is being set, and it's happening for a reason. It's all happening for a purpose. Look at verse 7. "Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, 'Shall I go and call a nurse for you from the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child for you?' And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, 'Go.' So the maiden went and called the child's mother." Now, how did that happen? I see the hand of the Lord specifically right there. "Then Pharaoh's daughter said to her, 'Take this child away and nurse him for me, and I will give you your wages.'" She gets to get paid for taking care of her own son. "So the woman took the child and nursed him. And Moses, the child, grew, and she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. And so she called his name Moses, saying, 'Because I drew him out of the water.'" Now, Moses, that's what his name means, by the way. Drew out of the water, basically, right? Drew out. There's the mother, which is interesting because it wasn't his mother that named him, but it was the Gentile, right? The Pharaoh's daughter that actually gave him the name. But the mother lays her child by faith and trusting the Lord is going to take care of him. The Lord knows what he's going to do. And by faith, she has to let go. And she gave her child into the Lord's hand. And I love that. It's almost like a baby dedication, right? In fact, this would be like the first baby dedication we see where a parent, the parent's love for their child has to just, you know, hand them over completely, 100% to the Lord and say, "Lord, they're yours." And you know what happened? The Lord brought Moses back to the mother. And she recognized that Moses wasn't hers anymore, that Moses belonged to the Lord. Isn't that cool? I think we should do the exact same thing with our families, with our, you know, think about it financially, think about every aspect of our lives. We should hand over to the Lord. And what I notice that the Lord does is he hands it all the way back to you again. And it's like, and then, it, you know, he says, "Here, take care of this. This is mine now." And it's no longer ours for our own gain. Turn to Acts chapter 7, by the way. I want to show you guys something. Acts chapter 7, because in Exodus chapter 2, verse 10 through 11, there's a 40-year gap of time that's not recorded in Exodus, but in Acts chapter 7, you guys remember the first martyr, Stephen, he gave some history here, some information about what happened during this time. Acts chapter 7, look at verse 20. It says, "At this time Moses was born and was well-pleasing to God, and he was brought up in his father's house for 3 months. But when he was set out Pharaoh's daughter took him away and brought him up as her own son. And Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was mighty in words and deeds. Isn't that interesting? Later on, we're going to see that Moses had basically a stutter, and he wasn't able to go before Pharaoh, even to say simple words like, "Let my people go." It had to be Aaron, we're going to see, is the one who's actually going to be speaking on behalf of Moses, even though he was learned in Egypt. I see similarities to Paul, maybe because we're in Acts. But Paul was learned, and instead of God sending him to the Jews, God sent him to the Gentiles. And here again, there's something the Lord's doing again here. It says, "And Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptian, who was mighty in words and deeds. Now when he was 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel." So now it occurs to him to do what the Lord has called him to do, if you will, to Lord, you know, whatever the Lord's will is. And the movies actually show that he didn't know who he was, but Scripture makes it very clear that he understood that he was a Hebrew. He knew who his people were. So when you guys are watching movies, be careful. Don't fall for all the, you know, Hollywood has to make it, you know, interesting, but they leave out a lot of things. But look at verse 24 of Acts chapter 7. Verse 24, it says, "And seeing one of them suffer wrong, he defended and avenged him who was oppressed, and struck down the Egyptian, for he supposed that his brethren would have understood that God would deliver them by his hand." So Moses at this point understood fully what God's will was for his life. He understood immediately his ministry, if you will, at this point, but the rest of the Hebrews didn't understand. It says, but they did not understand. And the next day, he appeared to two of them as they were fighting, and he tried to reconcile them, saying, "Men, you are brethren. Why do you wrong one another?" But he who did his neighbor wrong pushed him away, saying, "Who made you a ruler and a judge over us?" Well, God did, duh. "Do you want to kill me as you did the Egyptian yesterday?" Then Moses' eyes got lit up, right? Like, wait, what? Then at this saying, Moses fled and became a dweller in the land of Midian, where he had two sons, which is interesting. In fact, turn to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, because for 40 years, Moses was being raised in the house of Pharaoh, by Pharaoh's daughter. And Josephus tells us that Pharaoh's daughter was barren. In other words, she didn't have any children. And so Moses would be her one and only child. And living 40 years in the household of Pharaoh. Keep that in mind. In Hebrews tells us a few things about Moses's his faith, right? Because all of Hebrews 11 is all about the hall of faith, right? But it shows us his faith in Moses' position. Notice in Hebrews 11, verse 23, it says, "By faith Moses, when he was born, was hidden 3 months by his parents because they saw he was a beautiful child and they were not afraid of the king's command." So remember, 40 years has passed by at this point. And in Hebrews 11, verse 24, it says, "By faith Moses, when he became of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter." So by faith, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Interesting. He became mighty in words and wisdom of the Egyptians, and he learned all of their ways, right, and what they knew. But his faith is seen in the fact that he had faith in God's plan and not in position. It would have been easy for Moses to say, "You know what, if you think about it, I'm probably going to be second in command to Pharaoh. So if he dies, I'm basically going to be in charge. Then I can let God's people go," right? But that's the way people think. And we reason in our own mindset. And we got to realize, no, it's not what we think. It's what God's will is, right? And this is where we know God's will. And we got to recognize it's not about what we think. So it's always a mistake, by the way, when we think we can help God, right? Especially with position. But it's not about position. It's about faith in God's position and where God wants us to be. We always think if only we got it, you know, in a specific position, then, Lord, I would bless you. Or if you gave me this much money, oh, think of all the missionaries I can give this money to. Or think of all the, you know, what are you doing now, though? You know what I mean? There's people that say those things. I mean, even a dollar, $10 comes a long way for somebody if you're going to sponsor them. And if you don't have $5, you know, to give right now, what makes you think that you're going to give later on when, you know, all this does happen? So that's the mindset that a lot of people have. If only I had a position, if only I had money, if only I had this and that. But this is fairy tale land in a lot of our minds. We got to recognize what is God's will, not what we think. See, what we think is, man, I would have a comfortable life. I would have peace if I'm on the hammock all day here and drinking lemonade. And right? No, it's not what we think. It's what God, His Word says. So we see Moses' faith, by the way, by his possessions as well. If you're still there in Hebrews 11, look at verse 26. It says, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. For he looked to the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. So all the possessions of Egypt were at his possession, right? At his fingertips, basically. And he chose the sufferings of God's people instead. In other words, he chose to be like a common man. Which is interesting. Why? Because he was looking to the reward. Just like Paul said, the same thing in Philippians 3, verses 7 through 11. But he's looking forward, right? He's pressing on, and he's looking on to Jesus. And that's exactly what we should do. So back to Exodus chapter 2. We mentioned there was a 40-year gap between verse 10 and verse 11. I just wanted to throw some of those verses at you in Hebrews to get an idea of what's going on at this point. Let's come to the third thing, the fleeing of Moses. The fleeing of Moses in verses 11 through 15, after 40 years in the household of Pharaoh, we see here in verse 11, now it came to pass in those days when Moses was grown, that he went out to his brethren and looked at their burdens, and he saw an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, one of his brethren. And so he looked this way and that way, and when he saw no one, he killed the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. So here is Moses, the man of faith, the man who trusts in the Lord, right? You know, he's willing to go, you know, the path that God has for him. He's willing to give up all the treasures and the possessions. But here he sees his own, you know, Hebrew family, if you will, getting beat up. He goes in there to defend him, kills the Egyptian soldier, murders him. And if that's not enough, he looks both ways and he hides him in the sand, right? And I think that's interesting. You know, here we see a man who sinned. When we look at Moses, when we look at all these greats in the Bible, we always think that they're so perfect, right? But they were just like us, right? In other words, there's no partiality in Christ. We're all sinners. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. So it's very interesting. But notice in verse 12, it says he looked this way and that way. So in other words, he got his eyes off the Lord. He's looking this way, he's looking that way, and he looked everywhere else besides looking to the Lord. And notice he put the Egyptian in the sand, right? He hid him in the sand. I think we're good at hiding things. We could be really good at hiding things from family, from coworkers, from you know, people all around us, and we're really good at it when we want to. But we got to keep in mind that the Bible says in Proverbs 15 verse 3, the eyes of the Lord are in every place, keeping watch on the evil and on the good. Hebrews 4:13 says, and there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. So Moses was a man of faith, but it doesn't mean that he was perfect as well, right? So you and I are not perfect, but we can still walk by faith. That's what we're called to do, right? We're not to walk by sight, but by faith. And so let's look at verse 13. It says, "And when he went out the second day, behold, two Hebrew men were fighting. And he said to one who did the wrong, 'Why are you striking your companion?' Then he said, 'Who made you a prince and a judge over us? Do you intend to kill me as you killed the Egyptian?' And so Moses feared and said, 'Surely this thing is known.' And when Pharaoh heard of this matter, he sought to kill Moses. But Moses fled from the face of Pharaoh and dwelt in the land of Midian. And he sat down by a well." Now Moses would be used to deliver his people, and we're going to find that out later on. And we know this was done by faith, according to Hebrews chapter 11. But Midian, by the way, is near the Arabian Peninsula, near the Gulf of Aqaba and the Red Sea. So very interesting. Now let's go to the fourth thing here, is the marriage of Moses. The marriage of Moses, it's going to be in verse 16. This brings him to the area of Midian, and he's going to be here for 40 years, by the way. Look at verse 16. It says, "Now the priest of Midian," and we know that's Jethro, "had seven daughters, and they came and drew water, and they filled the troughs to water their father's flock." Verse 17, "Then the shepherds came and drove them away, but Moses stood up and helped them and watered their flock." And so you can see the Charlton Heston scene right here, right? Am I the only one? I read Exodus and I'm seeing all these like movie clips. Look at verse 18. It says, "When they came to Raul, their father, he said, 'How is it that you have come so soon today?' And they said, 'An Egyptian delivered us from the hand of the shepherds. And he also drew enough water for us and watered the flock.' And so he said to his daughters, 'And where is he? Why is it that you have left the man? Call him that he may eat bread.' Then Moses was content to live with the man, and he gave Zipporah, his daughter, to Moses. And she bore him a son and called his name Gershom. For he said, 'I have been a stranger in a foreign land.'" So we know, according to Acts chapter 7, that she bore him two sons. And so Moses takes a wife, has a son, becomes a shepherd there in Midian. Isn't that interesting? For 40 years, Moses grew up in Egypt, learning the ways of the Egyptians. But God said, you know, he put it in his heart then, at 40 years old, that for his people, basically, he was determined, he knew his calling, right? He knew, he expected, "Hey, you should be looking at me as your, who put you as a king over us," right? Kind of a thing. And but God didn't, he gave him a calling, but he didn't want to use him quite yet. He had to take him through training and boot camp first. So for the next 40 years, he will be a shepherd tending the sheep out in the desert, out in the wilderness, dirt slapping his face, right? Being humbled, if you will. And I think that's interesting, because even with Paul, we're in Acts, right? And we're talking about Paul. But for 3 years, he had to go to the desert of Arabia. And for 3 years, he was taught by the Lord himself. And he had to just take a pause, if you will. It was like being homeschooled by the Lord himself. And it says in Galatians chapter 1, verse 17 about Paul, it says, "Nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were apostles before me, but I went to Arabia, and I returned again to Damascus. And there, then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem," and then, you know, it goes on. But we're told, you know, he spent 3 years there. So did God choose to use Moses to deliver the children of Israel? Yes. Did Moses know about his calling? Yes, right? We already learned about that. And yet, God wasn't quite ready for him to be used quite yet, which I thought was interesting. You see, when God calls us to do something for him, good. Hey, praise the Lord. That's awesome. But it may not mean right away. And that's where prayer comes in. If the Lord's calling you somewhere, it may be for a time to come. It may not be immediate. And so it's always wise to pray. It's always wise to say, "Lord, okay, I know this is where you're calling me, but is this right now? And waiting on the Lord, it's a good thing to do, and just seek the Lord. No wonder the Bible says like crazy, you know, in Isaiah 40, verse 31, but those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. So why wait? Because, well, it'll be done in God's perfect timing. It won't be done in your timing. In fact, if you do it in your timing, you're going to ruin, you know, not only things for yourself, but for everyone around you. Because then you're going in the flesh if it's not the Lord's timing. And then it becomes, you know, a work based mentality. And then you get, you know, bummed out, and then you get dried out, and then ministry is just not fun, right? It's like it becomes a burden. And it's because you're trying, right? You're trying to accomplish something and make it a certain way, and it has to be perfect, but we're not perfect. And thus the results are never perfect, right? And then it gets very complicated. You're like, why aren't I perfect? Maybe just back off and just pray and seek the Lord. When you're in the Spirit, the things are done perfectly because in His eyes it's done perfectly, but in our eyes, we may be seeing things differently. That's why it's so important to align ourselves with the Word of God, right? So that we understand His will. Look at verse 23 and let's finish this up. Now it happened in the process of time that the king of Egypt died. Then the children of Israel groaned because of the bondage. And they cried out, and their cry came up to God because of the bondage. So this has been 400 years. And after 400 years, they cry out to the Lord. It's almost like they finally cry out to the Lord. And He hears them. Look at verse 24. So God heard their groaning, and God remembered His covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. And God looked upon the children of Israel, and God acknowledged them. So God hears them, He sees them, and He knows them. And when we're going through a tough time, remember that God sees us. He knows us. He hears our prayer. But don't forget to ask the Lord for help in time of need. Don't forget to ask the Lord, Lord, when is Your perfect timing? When do You want to do a work in me? And is the Lord not faithful to lead us and guide us and direct us? He sure is, right? He's wonderful. That's His name. Isaiah 9:6, right? And so He knows how to do everything in the life He's given us. It's perfect when it's done in Him. Amen, church? Amen. We did 2 chapters. Good job. You guys are intense. Should we have gone through maybe next week we'll do 4. Just joking. You guys won't show up. we'll see. We'll do a chapter at a time. Let's go ahead and pray and give us time to the Lord. Lord, thank You so much for the reminder. It just feels so drawn out. There's so much here, Lord. But what a blessing, Lord, to know that You had a plan for Moses' life, Lord, and You have a plan for ours, Lord. And we can look back at those who You used in history, and they served You by faith. Lord, teach us to walk by faith. Lord, give us those eyes in those times, Lord, when we want to try to just give up and let go and let You, Lord, may Your will be done in our hearts. I pray that You would overcome those areas of our lives, Lord. Strengthen us in our weaknesses, that we might be pleasing in Your sight, Lord, that we might walk by faith and not by our own sight. We love You, Lord, and we pray that You go before us tonight. Bless, continue to bless Your word as we go, Lord. May we continue to meditate on it, consider what Your word says. In Jesus' name, amen.